the ATI in the questionnaire was the opportunity that it provided for me to explore in the same sample relations between approaches to teaching and the other elements of the teaching learning environment that were represented as important conditions for good teaching. I wanted to link that together. This had mostly to do with the teaching learning environment. As I told you, the ATI represents two scales that show different approaches, a student focused and the teacher focused. And the factor analysis that I conducted confirmed this description. And exploratory factor analysis, I used exploratory factor analysis to test if the items, these 14 items that represented important conditions for good teaching would group together in some way, which they did, into four factors. And when I inspected those four factors further, they seem to group together the items based on their conceptual relationships. So I labeled them based on this nature, this conceptual, what was the nature of it. And the first one I labeled conditions encouraging active learning. That was the first scale. The second was concern for the student perspective. The third one had to do with including all research in teaching. This was did not come as strongly out as the other two, but anyway, they did. And the last one, the fourth one, was including exams in assessment. And I wanted to investigate how these four scales would link to the two approaches to teaching skills. So I did a factor analysis on that, and this came out.
I'm sorry. Αυτή η ανάλυση παραγόντων, θα σου πω τώρα τι είναι το καθένα από αυτά, και δίνει δύο παράγοντες. Τι έκανε λοιπόν μετά την ανάλυση των συνεντεύξεων, έκανε συγκεκριμένες ερωτήσεις που τις έβαλε στα ερωτηματολόγια, τα οποία ερωτηματολόγια περιείχαν τις ερωτήσεις που οι τέσσερις πρόσωποι, αυτοί που μιλάνε για τις προσεγγίσεις στη μάθηση, έχουν κατασκευάσει. Έτσι λοιπόν είχε τις ερωτήσεις αυτών, οι οποίες δίνουν δύο παράγοντες. Η μία είναι ότι είναι student-oriented, student-focused approach, και η άλλη είναι tutor-focused approach. Και βρίσκει λοιπόν ότι αυτά που βρήκε από τις συνεντεύξεις της και τα χωρίζει εκεί πέρα conditions, encouraging, active learning και αυτά, concern for the student perspective, including our research in teaching και το τελευταίο, including exams and assessment, αυτές είναι δικές της κατηγορίες μετά από διάφορες αναλύσεις ποιοτικές. Τις βάζει λοιπόν μέσα στην ανάλυση παραγόντων, μαζί με τις δύο βασικές κατηγορίες οι οποίες προκύπτουν από τα ερωτηματολόγια, για να δει τελικά αν αυτά που βρίσκει ότι πραγματικά ενισχύουν τη διδασκαλία σε βάθος, ενοιολογικά ταιριάζουν με αυτή την πολύ εδρεωμένη προσέγγιση που αφορούσε τις προσεγγίσεις στη διδασκαλία. Το επιβεβαιώνει λοιπόν, διότι το πρώτο έρχεται από το ερωτηματολόγιο, το conceptual change και το student focused approach. Εκεί πέρα κάθονται από κάτω, αντί τη δική της παράγοντες που σχετίζονται με αυτό. Και ο παράγοντας ο δικός της που ήταν αφορούσε να βάλουμε εξετάσεις και να αξιολογήσουμε, να κάνουμε και να φτιάξουμε, έρχεται να κάνει loading μαζί με το information transmission, δηλαδή με εκείνους τους διδάσκοντες οι οποίοι θεωρούσαν ότι αυτό που είναι να κάνουν είναι να δώσουν την πληροφορία και να καταλάβουν τις έννοιες. Άρα λοιπόν φτάνει σε ένα σημείο που πια λέει ότι τα ποιοτικά μου δεδομένα έρχονται να καθίσουν καλά και να συνδυαστούν με αυτό που είναι εδρεωμένο θεωρητικά πολύ καλά στη θεωρία. Άρα είναι έγκυρα και πάνω σε αυτά μπορώ να κάνω την υπόλοιπη ανάλυση. Okay, Άννα.
So the first factor linked the conceptual change scale from the ATI to three of the scales, conditions encouraging active learning, concern for the student of safety, and including own research and teaching. While a second factor coupled together the information transmission scale from the ATI and including exams in assessment. So this analytical process revealed relationships between the aspects found through testing the 14 items in this case and the scales, the 14 items that formed the four scales and the scales representing the ATI. And I see this as extending the dimensions contained in the ATI. It gives fuller information about the link between, well, the conceptions and approaches, you can say. But identifying these relations in the same sample between approaches to teaching and the other elements of the teaching learning environment also provided the opportunity to explore if these scales applied differently to different disciplines. As you remember, I chose four categories of disciplines and I wanted to know, is there a difference in how important these are, depending on the discipline? And that's why I did ANOVA. And here the table shows the six scales. And here we have the categories of disciplines. And what happened then? As highlighted in the red circles, a one-way between groups ANOVA showed some statistically significant differences between the disciplinary domains on all scales except the transmission scale. And the TACI postdoc test showed where the differences were. And I'm going to give just examples. And these were, for example, found between the hard disciplines and the soft disciplines on the conceptual change scale, which is the first one. The soft disciplines seem to be more inclined to use the conceptual change student-focused approach than the hard disciplines. As you see, there is no significant statistically significant differences on the information, and if you see the means, they are all lower than on the other. The soft applied disciplines were shown to be different from the rest of the disciplines with regard to concern for the student perspective. The soft applied disciplines seem to lean more towards the views that we reflected in this scale. On the other hand, the hard pure disciplines seem to be least concerned about the aspects inherent in that scale. And so, what I think this suggests is that teachers' perceptions of the extent to which these conditions are considered important in the quest for quality vary between different disciplines. And therefore, I allow myself to argue that this supports that disciplinary teaching learning cultures need to be taken into account in any discussion under which good teaching is likely to take place. This is a variable that we need to have on board. And then I come to the board. I'm moving towards the macro. But here we have the board institutional influences, which influence the conditions and going to the micro. These are rooted in various policy-related collisions. That is policies or operations of the institution as a whole. And as before, these influences derive from the analysis of the data, both the interviews and the questionnaire, and the document analysis also explained the context within which the views expressed originated. So, let's start with quality standards set in institutional policy. These refer most strongly to the emphasis on increased research activity. For example, the number of papers published in peer-reviewed international journals, which seem to be seen as an important means to gain status in international league tables. And we have also institutional policy about time distribution between teaching and research. You remember that I addressed teachers' allocation of their time. This influences exactly that. And in that discussion, the aspect was discussed that this affected the quality of teaching and how these duties are organized is decided in institutional policy. And then we have institutional policies on entry qualification and student numbers. And that goes with the level of students' entry qualification within the next set. The analysis of the data showed that some faculties found themselves as being encouraged to recruit more students, and that was done to maximize income and throughput of students. And in this context, the view was expressed that this element might adversely affect the standard set. Because the university tried, for budgetary reasons, to get as large a proportion of students as possible completing their studies. And thus, this can be seen as being part of broader institutional policies on entry qualification and student numbers that need, in my view, to be highlighted when considering influences which affect the implementation of new teaching. Institutional decisions on distribution of teaching resources across faculties. I mentioned the constraining conditions that teachers find themselves in as a consequence of large student numbers, and I pointed out that these were considered to stem from the level of staffing in course, which in turn was the consequence of level of funding provided for each course, and these influences have their origin at the measure level, that is here. That's where the decision is made, but in fact it's based on governmental decision, which you will see in the macro. And then we have institutional reaction to global research competition. Drawn from the findings, the emphasis laid on research in the quality standards set for the in institutional policy seems to be in some respect affecting the quality of teaching, that is, more reward for research than teaching. And then there is this special aim that this particular university has. That is the aim to be ranked among the 100 best universities in the world. Again, research is an influential factor here. The analysis of institutional policy showed that quantitative measures, such as scholarly output, measured in refereed papers, was highlighted as an important quality criteria in aiming to become one of the 100 best. That means that the main emphasis is put on research rather than teaching. as a way to fulfill that thing. And then we are reaching to the end. The second last is the institution of teaching policies. Teaching policies are one aspect of influence that I place here at the meso level. This aspect affects disciplinary learning cultures, which are partly derived from faculty policy of culture, but also partly from the policy of the institution with regard to the curriculum and teaching practices. And that in turn is influenced by the Bologna process, which is at the macro aspect. The analysis of the institutional policy showed emphasis laid on teaching methods that would promote the quality of study and take into account both students' needs and special status of individual disciplines. And therefore, I think I can argue that these different cultures are recognized in the institutional policy. As I said, it was important to recognize them. And lastly, but most strongly, was the promotion criteria. Both the data from the interviews and the research of the questionnaire show tension found in teachers' reflections about how they managed to fill their academic duties, and this was closely linked to the promotion system. It was a commonly expressed view that in the system, research is given higher status and reward, and they even said that sometimes teaching was looked upon like a kind of punishment for those who are not successful enough in research. If you're not successful enough in research, you have to teach more and more and more. That's the system in my school, for example.
Okay. Let me give you a couple comments here. Αυτά είναι όλα πράγματα που είναι δικά μου, δεν είναι δικά μου. Απλώς να πω ότι η πολιτική είναι ότι παίρνεις, μετά, αν θέλετε μπορείτε να τη ρωτήσετε, πρέπει να συμπληρώσει κάποια point μέσα στη χρονιά ή μέσα στα τρία χρόνια που έχει, ας πούμε, το συμβόλαιο. Εάν δημοσιεύσεις, ας πούμε, ένα άρθρο μόνος σε ένα διεθνές περιοδικό που είναι τα top-top, ας πούμε, όχι μόνο στα Springer και στα Elsevier, αλλά ένα περιοδικό που θεωρείται ότι έχει, ας πούμε, τρία εντάξει. Εκείνο το άρθρο, λοιπόν, παίρνει 20 points. Αν πάρεις αυτά τα 20 points, μπορείς να κάνεις ελάχιστη διδασκαλία. Όσο λιγότερο δημοσιεύεις, δηλαδή στα προσύνη σε διεθνή συνέδρια, αν έχεις ένα πράγμα και το έχεις μαζί με κάποιους άλλους, παίρνεις 5 points. Τα υπόλοιπα 20, πόσο έχεις τη χρονιά, πρέπει να κάνεις teaching. Όσο λιγότερο, λοιπόν, δημοσιεύεις, τόσο περισσότερες ώρες διδασκαλίας κάνεις. Και είναι λίγο, γι' αυτό λέω κάποια στιγμή, είναι λίγο με τιμωρία η διδασκαλία. Δηλαδή, αν δεν κάνεις αυτό που πρέπει, όπως είναι μετρημένο και δεν είναι γενικά μετρημένο, είναι πολύ ειδικά μετρημένο. Έχουν δηλαδή μια λίστα. Σου λέει, αν δημοσιεύσεις εκεί, παίρνεις 2 points. Αν δημοσιεύσεις εκεί και άλλοι 3, παίρνεις 5 points. Αν δημοσιεύσεις σε τέτοιο περιοδικό, αλλά αυτό. Άρα λοιπόν, αθροίζεις ότι δημοσιεύεις και ότι μένει, κάνεις διδασκαλία. Αν δεν δημοσιεύεις, θα διδάσεις για πάντα. Εντάξει, εν πάση περιπτώσει, δεν το λέω λίγο έτσι αυτό, αλλά είναι πολύ ξεκάθαρο, δηλαδή, ποιο είναι το παιχνίδι. Εντάξει. Οκ, you will give more information on that afterwards. Σε που κατεξάρει.
Now it's the last layer of the mountain. That is, these are the external influences affecting teaching, the ones that come from outside the institution. And first then, we have the government policies on entry qualification and student numbers. It's, you have seen in also in the MESO, at the MESO level. In the layer, describing the specific institutional conditions affecting teaching are to attend attention to class sizes and the level of students entry qualification. And based on the analysis of the data, I assume that institutional policy on student entry might be affected by the competitive element between universities, but also the incentives inherent in the funding model to maximize throughput and income by recruiting as many students as possible. more students, more money. Thus, this can be seen as an external factor influencing.
Επίσης, ναι, πληρώνω, καταλάβετε με το κεφάλι. Αυτό είναι και στην Αγγλία του. Δηλαδή, όσο περισσότερο φοιτητέ έχει, περισσότερα χρήματα παίρνει και το πανεπιστήμιο, αλλά και εσύ. Άρα, εντάξει, για να επιβιώσουν τα πανεπιστήμια, πρέπει και άλλου κάτι, πρέπει να διδάξουν βεβαίω αυτού του κι άλλου.
Teaching practices with every disciplinary community. I allow myself to assume that the disciplinary differences only are part of cultures at the faculty or institutional level, but also stem from teaching practices within the disciplinary community in a global context. And as such, they stem from the macro level then, because they come from outside the university. We have cultures, probably similar cultures within the teaching department here. Teaching department in my school, I believe. And then we have the Bologna process. The Bologna process, as it appeared both in the interviews and in the questionnaire, showed that the staff seemed to be content with the emphasis, for example, the emphasis put on learning outcomes as part of the process. They believed that the specification of learning outcomes for the study programs and for the courses would enhance quality within the system. This seemed also to be the case with other quality mechanisms of the Bologna process, such as the accreditation exercise. This very same view was also found in institutional policy. The introduction of the Bologna process in Iceland in the parliamentary bill that I analyzed on universities showed that adapting to the Bologna process was viewed as a means to strengthen the position of Icelandic universities in the European educational area and internationally. Thus, it seems that there is a general consensus at all levels that the Bologna process, including quality assurance, serves as an effective means to enhance the quality of higher education. Then we have government views about priorities in higher education, and then we come, in fact, again to the Bologna process. In the review of documents, for example, the parliamentary bill that I mentioned, it was clear that the Bologna process was seen as a response to concerns about quality assurance in higher education, and great emphasis was being laid on quality control, and this was also the case for the Icelandic government. This aspect is emphasized in governmental documentation. And then we have global research competition. To go back to my discussion of influences at the meso level, I noted that many of the teachers had expressed the view that research was more clearly rewarded than teaching. The analysis of policy declarations from the governmental authorities showed that investment in research was seen as an important means and a driving force for economic growth. Thus, the framework set by government indicates that universities are seen as having a very important role in economic growth through enhancing research. Thus, the emphasis on research that I have drawn attention to in various contexts in the Norden needs to be recognized among the external forces also, and those impinge upon the quality of teaching, therefore. And last, we have this that I mentioned a few times before, the governmental model that determines the financial allocation to universities. The financial model that the Ministry of Education uses was seen in various ways to have marked impact on individual academics as well as affecting policy at faculty level. The model is based on so-called effective units. I don't know if you know what that is. So units per each student that completes his study. And this is the measure that Ministry of Education uses to determine the contribution to the institution. And this system or model consists of 7 budget categories based on discipline domains. And it provides different funding based on the what discipline it is. Different funding for full-time student equivalents. And it ranges from humanities and social sciences that get the lowest budget. Are you surprised? No. To dentistry that gets the highest. And now I want to refer to the results of the questionnaire that showed how clearly an obstacle was seen in this funding model and how it works. Because more than 2/3 of the respondents saw it as an inhibiting factor standing in the way of providing conditions needed for good teaching. So it was very clear what they felt about this model and how it worked. So, so these are my main findings of these here. But what I did in addition was to try to draw together the lines of influences, how something at the macro level goes into the meso and the region. And so I'm going to put all of them except one. And as you see, I have now added arrows to show them the lines and to suggest the direction of these influences. And you see that throughout these lines both work within levels and between levels. There's a long one here, as you see. It has to do with research. But I want to follow the fourth line, which was the line on the financial model, and how that works. So if we start here, this influence came so clearly out of the data. And this is the governmental model that determines how what the university gets, and especially the departments. And these translate into institutional decisions with regard to distribution of teaching resources across faculties. And I found that, in fact, the institution uses, in fact, the same rule as the it gives the lowest budget to the social sciences and the highest to the dentistry. But as I understand it, they can, in some way, they have some flexibility, but they don't use this anymore. And this affects decisions of finance provided for its course. In the end, it does. And then the possibility of level of staffing, the possibility of, for example, hiring assistant teachers,
προσωπικό διδακτικό, οπότε το κάνουν όλο. Δεν έχει λεφτά, δεν παίρνει κανένα, το κάνει εσύ. Okay, thank you.
And lastly, this, for example, limits the teacher's ability to provide support and feedback as a they see as part of good teaching. And they feel that in particular assessment suffers from this. Because they want to have valid assignments and they want to give supportive feedback and appropriate one. And they don't have the short resources to do that. So they tend to use something that is easier to grade and to so that's how these lines seem to work all the way into the micro. So what was my conclusions? I'm just going to give you an overview. First, it seems that the academics had a very clear view and many ideas, a wealth of ideas, about what constitutes good teaching of good quality. And in fact, they were so glad to have this talk with me in the first place, because they said, it's so uncommon that I get a chance to talk about things like that. And they had a wealth of ideas. And they feel that in order to be able to teach in accordance with the conceptions of good teaching, so I come to the conceptions again, institutional and external conditions and influence need to be of a kind that facilitates such teaching. That were the conditions that they came out so strongly in the both in the interviews and were confirmed in the questionnaire. But the findings indicate that this is not the case. There's various institutional conditions as well as external forces that seem to be at work and constrain their ability in this is their perception of things, to teach in a way that harmonizes. Remember when I started with the literature about preferred approaches and then what makes them move away from their approaches. It harmonizes with their conceptions of good teaching. I put down a few of my implications, both for research and for practice, as I see it. First, I'm hoping that my study will make a useful contribution to a better understanding of the way in which decisions at the three different levels interact, and that it will be used to a kind of harness both the ideas of the teachers and the competence of the staff, to ensure that the implementation of policy works in ways which encourage quality of teaching and learning. And I'm not sure that for example, those working in institutional policy are quite aware of what the decisions that they make may mean on the floor. And that is something that we need to do something about. And then I'm thinking also about what are the implications for research. I would strongly emphasize the student perspective in addition to these levels. And how students see quality of teaching in light of the aims of their study, and what they are prepared to invest in their education, in terms of time and effort. And also, I think it will provide valuable information, in my view, to explore the harmony between the students' views and the teachers' views on what constitutes good teaching. It would be interesting to know. And for practice, I say, I think that at least based on my findings for that institution and for my institution too, we need to establish a serious conversation about the issues that the study addresses and the findings. That is, the conversation needs to take place between various agents, but perhaps specifically between the institution and the staff. I think that's necessary. And that means
thank you very much. Thank you, Anna, for this presentation, this interesting, detailed presentation. And of course, a lot of thanks to Eva for the assistance and the clarifications. And now we will pass to the following step with remarks and queries about the presentation. Please, Michali.
That guided your research. I think that there was an assumption in your research concerning student-centered learning and the conceptual change on the one hand, and on the other hand there was the assumptions of teacher-centered learning identified with information and transmission. I think we are we're engaged to question on what grounds the researcher infers that theory transmission is information transmission. Mm-hmm. And the second question concerns whether this identification, assumption of identification of guiding the research process forced you to find what you had presupposed. Am I clear?
That's a good question.
The sense that obtained was that you found what you have presupposed according to these theoretical assumptions.
Mm-hmm. Can I answer that one first?
Oh, yes, please.
I was thinking, I didn't tell you about how I went about the interview in the first place. It's tell something about